Welcome back, everybody, to the Warriors to Racers Vodcast. I'm Ed McLean, the director for Warriors to Racers. And I'm very excited tonight to have with us AJ and Rebecca from Follow On Mission. They're doing some amazing things. They've worked with one of our veterans already. We'll talk about that here in a little bit. AJ, Rebecca, welcome. And would you like to introduce yourselves and tell us a little bit about you?
All right, AJ Jackson, semi-recently retired U.S. Army Special Forces, been involved either pure athletics or motorsports in one form or another since I was about 5 or 6 years old. So, lovely wife, Rebecca.
I'm Rebecca, yep, I'm his wife, and yeah, so where do you want to start? We got a really long story, and I don't think everybody wants to hear our whole life, but... yeah.
Well, obviously, you've created a program called the Follow On Mission, and you've just in the very short amount of time that I've known what you all are doing with it, I'm pretty amazed. Could you tell us a little bit about your program and kind of what your focus is, and kind of take it from there?
Sure. Yeah. The Follow On Mission, retired from Special Forces. And, this is my follow on mission. I had once my teen time was over, started seeing behavioral health professionals. And once things kind of stopped for an adrenaline junkie and you become a staff guy or a teacher in Special Forces, that's when the demons start to really pile on. That's when all that combat stuff really hit you, and it hit me very, very quickly. I was racing bicycles, raced motorcycles, injuries started to pile up, and the surgeons finally said, you're just going to have to quit racing the bicycle. And that started the dark suicide spiral. And they had been coaching me all along, behavioral health professionals, you've got to find another outlet. This bicycle thing isn't going to last. You have to find another outlet. And just by the grace of God, I stumbled across Lennon's video and wound up emailing that organization, and they put me in touch with Battle Scarred Motorsports. And we had raced with them, really liked the idea of getting vets in cars. We wanted to take it a little bit further. We retired from the military, moved back to the Midwest. And rather than start another chapter of Battle Scarred, we started the Follow On Mission. And with this, we wanted to take it another step further. We're going to provide adrenaline therapy through an intense team experience through motorsports, but we wanted to do it at no cost to the drivers. We didn't want that renting that seat, that driver's fee, having to buy equipment. We didn't want that to be we didn't want that to stop anybody. It would be a barrier to entry to experience this, and it's once they experience this, if it's something that is going to help. And I think everybody we've had in the car so far has really expressed that it's a notable change for them. Maybe they can reorganize priorities and go ahead and make this a priority to where they can move up through the ranks, WRL, and maybe move towards some of those rental seats. But for now, this is no cost to drivers. You do have to show up and do rehearsals, safety drills, things like that, car familiarization. But other than that, we're going to put you in gear. We're going to do everything for you and get you out there on the track. Sorry, kind of rambling there, but I get excited about it.
Well, that's really awesome. And that's the part that I think is really amazing, is that you're getting drivers into the cars at no cost. Yeah. That is really... really saying something for the folks that are watching this video that maybe aren't familiar with the costs that go into these cars. While AJ and Rebecca, you're doing primarily Champ Car. Is that correct with this?
We just put our race schedule together for this year, and it's about 60-40 Champ Car to Lemons, just for the locations of the track and our board's availability, so as far as support staff and things like that go. So, yeah, we're pretty excited to do both those series.
Yeah, and we can, we've got the computer under the dash. We can tune the car for either series with just a couple keystrokes on the computer. So,
oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
The the cost load is what I was trying to get at. Yeah, Lemons and Champ Car, they're kind of considering the hierarchy of endurance racing. They are on the lower amateur scale. Lemons in particular being very focused on like easy access and people getting in the car, and it is lower cost, but there's still a substantial cost to getting these cars out there. What kind of strategies are you using, if you don't mind me asking, what kind of strategies are you using to take care of that cost? Is it something that you're getting sponsors for? And along those lines, if you are using sponsors, how would sponsors get in touch with you to sponsor your program?
So primarily up until now, this has been really kind of self-funded, family-funded, friends. We've been super blessed that people have just seen our vision, and they have that passion to help those veterans out there. I also just want to throw out there, we do help first responders as well. You know, anybody that's dealing with PTS, depression, just those downward suicide spirals. If we can help one person stop that suicidal spiral, we figure we've been successful. But you're right, the expense, there's a pretty high expense in maintaining these cars and getting them on the track. So the board, we've really been developing some strategies here in the last month or two. We're going to be talking to some businesses. We have some folks to talk to, because we really do need that support. I don't want to say necessarily corporate, but we need these people to come, as partners to come alongside us. One of the things we're trying to kind of focus towards as well is tapping into our board member. We got board members. We have AJ, but we have some other special operations guys, and their tools, their wheelhouse of specialty as far as problem solving and project management, things like that. We'd like to get some partnerships where we're able to, maybe somebody can help us out money wise, but we can help them solve their problems as well.
So yeah, a couple sponsors that I really need to mention is UMI Performance.
Yeah.
They, one of their sales reps is a friend of a friend. It's Josh Jones with Operational Speed Supply introduced us to UMI Performance. And the 78 Malibu we were racing, it was the old car I drove in high school, been sitting in my mom's pasture for probably close to 30 years. And we decided, hey, let's see if we can do something with this G-body. And UMI Performance heard about what we were doing. And they were on board literally before this car got pulled out of the field. And we started stripping it down to the frame. Another one is snake eater injection with fuel injectors. Green Bray brother of ours, I just ordered parts for him, and he sent me a $0 invoice. Maintains contact with us on tuning and things like that. And then Legion Metal and Speed Shop in Clarksville, Tennessee. He's our cage builder, just awesome guy. Another Green Beret. Mm-hmm. But yeah, on Rebecca's partnership, most partnerships aren't a true equity situation for both partners. What we're trying to do is, and what we're beginning to do, is leverage the network of retired special operators, all senior guys, and basically the baseline for us is like MBA and certified project director. We're looking to leverage this ability to corporations that, in exchange for a donation, a weekend partnership, and provide you a service at a much lower cost than what they would normally have to do going through if they went through the name brands in our network, going through the follow on rather than the actual name brand corporation.
That's really awesome that you've been able to pull folks together like that. I think you mentioned that a lot of veterans are pulling together with you on this, and to me, it just goes to show the veterans helping veterans piece coming together yet again. I think it's really amazing that those folks
Well, and I don't mean to interrupt, but I want to throw you out there as well. I mean, you know, you're another veteran, you know, you heard what we were doing, you reached out to us. I love the networking that we're doing. I love that we were able to bring one of your guys into our last race. We're super excited to see what the future has to hold. Starting this, you know, just the two of us, then we added a couple of board members, and you know, it's grown and expanded, and we're excited to see where it's going to go. But it's that kind of grassroots meeting other people seeing our vision, seeing the excitement behind it, and being willing to step up and help.
That's really cool. It's actually a good segue. We do have a couple of pictures here that I wanted to share. I will go ahead and bring those up now, if my computer will behave. And if you could go ahead and talk to it, except I don't have it open. Let's try this again. There we go.
Okay, yeah, that was... Road America this October in the rain. That's myself and Andy. Andy's a member of Air Force Special Operations. Looks like Andy's getting ready to jump in the car. He did a really, really good job with it. He's a high performance HPDE guy. First time wheel to wheel. Car was a little intimidating for him. We don't run power brakes, and we run a pretty healthy V8 in it in a lightweight car. But I think he had a blast. He was smiles all weekend. Andy really, he embraced the concept of what we do. He didn't show up to drive the car. He showed up to be a team member.
For sure.
So he was there unloading the truck, unpacking toolboxes, you know, setting tables up, prepping the car with us. Just dynamite guy. And I think the smile on his face truly reflects that, hey, I think mission accomplished.
And that's... Also, the segue is he is a Warrant Eraser member, and that's why it was the segue. But anyway, so here is the next one we had.
Yep, got a picture. That's Athena. Like you said, it's a 78 Malibu. Pulled it out of his mom's pasture. Been sitting there for about 30 years, and stripped her all the way down to. I mean, we sandblasted the frame and rebuilt her, put her back together. Technically, we actually set the motor back 15 inches. So there was a lot of engineering that went into this project. Our next car is not going to be quite as involved as this one was.
the only thing that remains 78 Malibu is just the suspension mounting points, the frame, and the sheet metal. Everything else is purely aftermarket or fabricated. Crank pulley is behind it's behind the front ball joint. So technically it is a mid-engine car. Really good balance on it. We're really proud of it. We've got some aerial work to do on it. Really, really proud of this one. This is kind of our showcase car. And we show it to potential donors and sponsors to show them that, hey, we're going to go above and beyond to do everything we can. We're going to spend your dollar in the most frugal way and make it go the farthest we possibly can.
Yeah. And are you doing all the work on this yourselves?
Yeah, we did have the interior sheet metal on it because the engine is set back. It has above the frame exhaust. A friend of mine runs a very successful mechanical design business, and for the interior, he shut his shop down for 3 weeks. And him and his two sons volunteered, and they CAD-CAM the interior, cut it out on a water jet, and TIG welded it all in there for us. And just one of those blessings. If we had to pay for mechanical design firm for 3 weeks of production, wouldn't have happened.
But definitely would have been cost prohibitive.
Yeah, as far as every car, I think Rebecca's touched every nut and bolt in it. Rebecca built the motor herself. I did the transmission. Rebecca did the motor and all the plumbing on it herself. I think I might have ran a couple brake lines, but fuel system, oil system, that's all motor. That's all Rebecca. I have some.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I've got some mobility issues. I can't really crawl in and out of the car. I can get in the driver's seat, and that's about as far as I can go. So
I'm usually the one that ends up, you know, upside down, and you know. But you know, that's one of the cool things about doing this restoration on this car, though, because as we built the car, I started to get him back. You know, his first, was it Champ Car, was your very first race?
Champ Car Coda.
His first Coda. It was his very first Champ Car race when we raced with Battle Scarred. And that was a tremendous experience and a great team to be a part of. And it was just night and day difference seeing him get into that car and then seeing him get out of that car. One of the really cool things is we are starting to work with a couple of people who are actually doing some of the neuroscience behind what we call the adrenaline therapy. Mm-hmm. And it's really showing that with endurance racing, that there's a huge difference because you spend 2 hours or, you know, 90 minutes to 2 hours behind the wheel, that sustained adrenaline really lets your brain and your body reacclimate to adrenaline. You know, normally it has the whole fight or flight, you know, fear, anger, anxiety, that whole thing. And after you spend 90 minutes behind the wheel and you reacclimate to, hey, this is fun, that there really is a shift in the brain. And that his first race is when we decided that when he retired, this is what we wanted to do. And then with rebuilding the 78 Malibu, as we put that car back together, it kind of put him back together too. Yeah. So it's been great.
That's really awesome. And that's really good to hear. I didn't mention it, you know, during our broadcast here. I had it in a previous one, but I think that's the part, particularly with both of our programs. Some people will look at it and go, oh, well, they're just doing it to go racing. That is not the reason why we're doing this. I don't know how you talk about, you know, a follow-on mission, but for Warriors to Racers, I'm like, it is to get veterans back onto a team, a high performance team, so we can support each other again and have that camaraderie that we had when we were on active duty.
Exactly.
When I came off of active duty, I was at a loss. You know, you go to the discharge office, say, here's your 214 and see you later.
Yeah.
That's literally about all you get.
Yeah.
There's no, you know, thanks for your service or whatever. You don't get that. It's just, here's your discharge paper. We'll see you later.
Yeah.
And you're like, I'm done. And they're like, yep.
Yeah. And now what do I do?
Yeah.
And I lost my best friend at the time. I lost him to suicide because he got out and just went into that downward spiral. And those are the things that we're trying to address to try to get people out of that downward spiral and back onto a team. The racing is a perk.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned, it is, but it's that high performance, high intensity team coming together, that is what the idea is behind it, not so much the fact that it's endurance racing, at least from my perspective. So
no, I totally agree. The team thing is super important. I'm really excited about the neuroscience studies that are being done on this thing though, because it really is taking that for those people who are struggling with the hyper vigilance, you know, hyper awareness all the time, being able to get in the car and focus that into something different instead of just looking for threats. You're looking for the line, you're looking for, you know, passing, you're looking for somebody that's coming up behind you trying to pass you, you know, whatever the case might be. Just really doing that brain shift. So it's pretty exciting stuff.
Yeah, suffering from hypervigilance, you get in a race car and then it just becomes good situational awareness. You're not worried about anybody's intent. You know where everybody is on the track. You're constantly looking in the mirrors, checking the sides, listening. And it just instantly goes from that hypervigilance. You know, I can't turn my brain off. I'm worried about everybody's action. Where are their hands to, hey, these guys are all on the racetrack, all going the same direction. We all have the same goal. And let's just work our way through it. It takes it from just a constant annoyance to, hey, it's a really good track to have on the tool, or really good tool to have on the track. And it's kind of fun. So.
Yeah. Let's see. Got one more picture, I think.
Yeah.
inside the car.
Yeah. We decided we wanted to go with a little bit of a, you know, we're open to all branches, first responders. We decided we wanted a little bit of a fighter cockpit look to the car. So it's got a console, and Rebecca actually designed and built most of this, but it actually has a console just above the shifter. All the switches, gauges are angled towards the driver. We do have mechanical, gauges, old, muscle car, white faced, black numbered gauges. But we do have an actual digital gauge in front of the wheel. Big shift, big light you see up there in the middle of the windscreen. That's not a shift light. That's the oil pressure light. That comes on. You immediately know something's wrong.
I had to make AJ move that light a little bit because he had it like right in the driver's face. Yeah. I'm like, you're gonna blind him. Yeah.
We wanted to hit the kill switch, not panic.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Hit the kill switch. Don't ram it into a wall because you can't.
That green light. That's just the Flagtronics digital signal thing. That's a. If you haven't raced the Flagtronics before, it's probably coming to your series. It's a wonderful thing. Electronic flagging right in the car.
Yeah, it's great. I'm pretty sure that that's Andy driving. I think so.
Red Blue.
I think that's Andy driving.
That's the only pictures I had, unfortunately, but.
You can always go to the followonmission.org. They have all kinds of pictures, probably way more than what people want to look at.
Yeah. kind of get back into some of the stories and whatnot. Could you give us, because obviously Andy was a success story.
Yeah.
Do you have any memorable success stories you want to share, or someplace where you think Follow On had a really significant impact?
Yeah, I'm actually going to go to our very first race that we ever had. We didn't have Athena ready to go yet. So a friend of ours, I tell you, I can't say enough about our friends that have come alongside us to try to help us with this, and just acquaintances throughout the race community and other veterans, because our car wasn't ready. We let somebody let us borrow their BMW for a champ car race.
It was a brand new spec E30, brand new spec. So
yeah, and we had he'd served. I don't know how long he served in the Marines.
I think 6 years in the Marines.
He's on the local police department here, and he's a SWAT team sniper, and so he's been through a lot. He was a little nervous about racing. He'd never done any kind of wheel-to-wheel racing before. Regular police training and that kind of thing, but never done any actual wheel-to-wheel racing. So he's a little nervous. The first day he got in the car and he was excited and nervous, but he enjoyed it. He had a good time, but he wasn't really quite making that shift that I saw in AJ the first time he did it. But day two comes around, and on Sunday, he got behind the wheel of that car. He cut minutes off of his lap times. He just had that shift all of a sudden, and all his hypervigilance went towards the race car. He got more comfortable. He got out of the car and has the biggest grin on his face. It's probably my favorite photo that's on our website. And I don't know if I can say this about tearing up, but the best thing, his wife and daughter were there. And they came up and hugged me and said that they hadn't seen him smile like that in 3 years. And so for me, not only is it helping the veteran, but it's helping those families. So sorry. I just love that story, though.
That is really, really awesome.
Yeah.
That is good to hear. You got me tearing up. So.
Sorry. for his wife and his daughter to say, hey, we haven't seen him smile like that in 3 years, and to see him do that. And it's great because, we don't see them on a regular basis, but we stay in touch, via Facebook, and he's kind of waiting he's still very busy with his work schedule. So we're kind of waiting for another local race so that he doesn't have to travel, and then we'll have him back out in the car again.
I didn't really touch on it. You mentioned local races. What events do you focus? We know it's, you know, Champ Car and Lemons. What specific tracks are you focused on?
We're focused on Midwest and Near South. We're in Missouri. We don't have a Ozarks International this year. We've got, I think, Road America twice, NCM, National Orbit Museum, Bowling Green, Kentucky. I think we have that twice.
Audubon, Virginia.
Audubon twice. And then I believe Jennings, Oklahoma is at Hallett Motorsports Park. But yeah, depending on budgeting, I would like to get, like me, get back down to MSR. And of course, everybody's got to get to Daytona.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And COTA was great.
I love COTA. If COTA ever comes back, we'll definitely do COTA again. That's just to, if you guys are watching, if you ever have a chance to get on that track, get on that track.
Yeah.
So.
And I do, I highly recommend Ozarks though. You know, it's a pretty new track to Mid-Missouri. That was the track that the race that I was just talking about, that was at Ozark. I absolutely love that track. I know a lot of people were intimidated when it first came out because of the elevation changes and the blind corners, but it's such a wide track. It's a super safe track. We had a great time.
Yeah.
So we're looking forward to either Lemons or Champ Car coming back there.
That's really awesome.
Yeah.
What have been, well, flip kind of, we'll change gears. Mm-hmm. Motorsport pun intended. what are some of the challenges and obstacles that you face?
Time is probably our biggest challenge. You know, it's just that it's been primarily the two of us working on the car. You know, a lot of our veteran friends are still in other states, so we don't have. I mean, but we've had like his childhood friend that, you know, did the interior of the car for us, and then, you know, a few hours away, roll cage and. But time is probably the big one. You know, funds make a difference. We really have a vision of, okay, right now we're getting people in the car at absolutely no charge, but we'd like to have it to the point where we could pay for their travel, we did provide most of the meals at Road America, but be able to pay for travel and hotel and all those expenses, so it's truly not a burden on somebody that wants to participate, and then be able to travel out to some of those other racetracks too. I mean, I'd eventually like it to be where we're even going out to California. So
that's really awesome. Obviously, you guys are really, really driven for the program and everything. You mentioned earlier too about expansion of the program. Is there future expansion that you're looking at? Any big goals that are coming up?
Yeah, here locally, we've started another car. It'll be more. We're trying to grow this into locally with us, a driver development program. We're starting a basic car, a basic Civic, unmodified engine. Once we get this self-sustained financially through our work, through our partnerships, once we get this local, me and Rebecca and our local board of directors, once we get this self-sustaining financially, we want to make this, we want to build other chapters. We're working on paperwork where we can just hand someone a binder of how do I build a Follow One mission chapter. And we'd like to have, you know, get up in New England, East Coast team, West Coast team, and then maybe somebody down in Florida.
Wow, so that's some pretty major planning going on there.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that we'll be working together in the future then, because that sounds like we're pretty close on goals and whatnot. So, is there any advice or insight that you would like to give any of the veterans out there that are considering getting into racing?
Yeah, absolutely. Give it a shot. You know, like I said, I've been involved pure athletics, motorsports, you know, then back to pure athletics with racing bicycles, sniper competitions, you know, fun. Well, I can't say fun runs in our line of work. There's no such thing as a fun run. Every run is a race. But this brings you back into that team environment. You get that same adrenaline rush, but it's fun again. If you have an interest in it, look us up. If you're not close, if our schedules don't gel, look into some other veteran opportunities. But our door's open. If the schedules mesh up, let's get you in the car and see how it feels.
Yeah, and you know, and even if you just have questions, just reach out. You can reach us via the website or email. You know, we're happy to talk to anybody at any time. And if your desires and things that you're interested in don't have anything to do with us, I mean, we've got a friend that does Patriot hunts. You know, he takes guys out hunting and things like that. We've got a pretty good network, and we're happy to get you hooked up with somebody else. If you have any inkling that you might want to try to drive a car, come talk to us. Like I said, you know, our very first driver that we had no wheel experience, and he did great. So we're going to get you the tools. We've got some training videos and things that we do with folks ahead of time. So we're going to make sure that you're prepared before you actually get in the car.
And you don't have to drive.
For sure.
Yeah. If you just want to dip your toe in the water, come out and pit crew. Come out, put the fire seat on, dump some gas in the car. You know, help us change tires. The door is always open to come and do that as well.
Yeah. And even if you just want to come hang out, Battlescar's got a guy, he's just priceless. He has no interest whatsoever in getting behind the wheel. He comes out and he cooks for everybody. So, I mean, you know, just come hang out with us and we'll find something that you like to do, and we'll definitely keep you busy.
That's really cool. Last question I'm going to ask you. This one might be a little on the personal side, but if you had the opportunity to give advice to your younger self, what would it be?
it's kind of... one of my prior lives, I've had several different professional jobs being a military spouse, but as a personal trainer for a while. And kind of my tagline to all my clients was no regrets. I mean, if there's something you want to try, get out there and try it. There's nothing worse than getting to the end of your life and thinking, well, I wish I would have tried this. And I can definitely say that we have tried everything we've been interested in trying to do.
As far as me, this is part of a talk that I give, but every prior decision, every prior action that I made put me exactly where I am right now. Mm-hmm. And I love being right here. And if just one little thing had changed, maybe I wouldn't be here. Maybe I would be somewhere else. So no regrets, things of my past that, you know, I'm ashamed of, wish I hadn't done, but those things put me where I'm at. So I get up every morning, embrace the day, go to the shop and do race car stuff.
Now, thanks very much. That is really, really good advice. But thank you for joining me tonight. I really appreciate you taking the time to do this, and really do appreciate your program. And I'm sure we'll be working together more very soon.
Yeah, Ed, thank you for your friendship. Thanks for your support. Just let us know what else we can do to support you.
Yeah, and likewise.
Okay. All right.
Thanks.
Thank you.